In April of 1965, I thought I was headed to Northwestern University to become a graduate student in astronomy. And then I got a call, kind of out of nowhere almost, from this fellow who was putting together a group within NASA at the Manned Spacecraft Center to figure out how to do orbital rendezvous. No one had ever done before, bringing two spacecraft together in orbit. And that's how I wound up 4 years later as the Apollo 11 rendezvous training instructor. It had been recognized about a year before we got into active flight operations with Apollo that there needed to be some kind of forum where anyone could bring in and bring up potential technical problems or issues that need to be resolved. And these were fairly important issues. These were things that could prevent you from attempting the mission or that, you know, might affect safety or the possibility of mission success. And so they set up under the chairmanship of a guy named Bill Tyndall. At the end of each meeting, Bill Tyndall would put out a sheet of action items, issues that had been come up or that were pending. And when I first started going to this meeting, this sheet would run for several single space type pages. And sometime about late May of 1969, there was a rumor went around that the sheet had gotten down to less than half a page. The list of items that would have to be figured out or fixed was decreasing. And so I went to that meeting. A lot of us were sitting in chairs around the edge of the room, and the people that had presentations to do were sitting at the table. And Bill Tyndall went around the table and asked if they had any further critical items. Each of them answered that they did not. And there was this dead silence for 10, 15 seconds, seemed like a long time, while everybody considered the fact that we had no more technical excuses not to attempt to land on the next mission, which was to be Apollo 11.
35 seconds and counting. We are still go with Apollo 11. 30 seconds and counting. Astronauts report it feels good. 2 minutes, 25 seconds. 20 seconds and counting. 2 minutes, 15 seconds. Guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9. Ignition sequence start. 6.
Started for me very young. I was maybe 3 or 4 years old, and the thing I remember, the moon was the first thing that drew me into astronomy. I was sitting with my grandmother, who grew up in Jacksonville, Florida, sitting there and looking through the trees at night, through the moss at the moon, and it just struck me as beautiful and romantic, and I've always had a mixture of a romantic and a scientific interest in it ever since.
My mom encouraged me to learn and explore. And so as a child, she would take me out at night and she'd point to the moon, she'd point to the stars. I learned some of the constellations. And I think we all have something inside of us where we feel connected when we look at those things. And even as a child, you realize there's something special about them.
I think my father fostered my interest. I do not actually come from a big science family, but I finally asked him only about 3 or 4 years ago how he got interested, and he told me that it was his mother who sat him down to read about the stars and the planets. And this is a grandmother I never knew. She saw me when I was 3 months old, and then she died. And it just was the most amazing feeling to think that this grandmother I never knew, who I'd always heard of as a homemaker, probably deeply affected my life through passing on this interest to my father, who passed it on to me. And then I think it was a huge impact just having the entire space program unfold. It was your entire childhood. And we only had 2 or 3 channels at the time, so I think all of America, when there was something that happened in space, sat their kids down in front of the TV. from the beginning of the space program to the moon landings.
We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon.
For me, it starts back when Kennedy made his great speech, you know, saying that we will land a man on the moon and return him safely within this next decade. And then that was punctuated, too, by in 63 when he was killed in November. And the way the nation was kind of ramping up and science was being funded, and then you could feel that almost feel things happening all the way through.
I mean, you didn't have to go to the moon to die. The test pilots were dying about the 25% rate.
You don't realize that, you know, pretty large percentage chance they wouldn't even make it back. I mean, President Nixon had prepared a speech to the country if they got stranded there. It was almost like the same type of speech you have if you're burying someone at sea. It was like burying them in space.
Well, working in safety at NASA, you see all of the things that could possibly go wrong. When they had the Apollo 1 fire that killed some astronauts just right on the ground, they learned a whole lot of lessons right there. When they were starting into this business, they were very naive. They believe in success, and that's what they focus on.
It's just different for our place in the universe to have ourselves there. And even though you're not that person, you can almost see the place through their eyes.
That July 20th was just, that was like, this was the culmination of everything the whole nation had been pushing for the previous decade, all through all the turmoil and dissent of the countercultural revolution and then the civil rights push, the Vietnam War, all of that, at least for a time, would drop away. A moment of clarity, really, for the nation.
Every single person was watching that. There was no one going out for dinner during this. There was no one driving around. You know, it was probably one of the biggest events ever.
When they came around from the backside of the moon, and it was very obvious they were, you know, engaged in the powered descent.
I still vividly remember the pictures coming in, but it was actually fairly ordinary as far as the setting. I was just in my living room. But the feeling was extraordinary. I think you all know that went throughout the world. It was almost like an electric bolt.
My cousins were all younger, and it was like, is that really the moon? And then as the module was coming down to the surface, there was basically dead silence, just watching.
It seemed ghostly at the time, which seemed appropriate in some ways, you know, that there they are, they're a quarter of a million miles away and up on this moon that I look at night, and it didn't seem inappropriate.
So when you're 12 years old, you're anxious. You're like, hey, get out there and do something. You know, you're wondering why, what's taking so long?
Well, some genius making up the activity plan for Apollo 11 said, well, the first thing that they'll do once they get down, since they'll have been up for probably 18 hours, is sleep. Well, can you imagine doing that if you're set down on the moon? First people ever to do it, sleeping for 3 or 4 hours? No. So the suggestion was made by the commander, Neil Armstrong, that perhaps they should begin to put on their suits and go out. Didn't seem likely anybody was going to get any sleep.
Going to the moon seemed really like impossibility becoming real life. I think that's what was so stunning about it.
I could hear him talking, and then I saw him move down.
I thought his name was Herb, and one of his neighbors, I remember him saying over and over, can you believe it, Herbie? Can you believe it, Herbie? He must have said it 100 times. It seemed to take forever to get down that ladder.
And it was dead silence in the room, you know, holding our breath like everybody else.
I really wanted to be there sharing it, but we shared it vicariously through television.
Something over 400,000 people involved in landing a man on the moon. That's a lot. It's like a war. And they take a toll on the people that are involved. After the first landing and downstream in Apollo, there were people that basically were burned out. There were marriages that were burned out. The weeks following the successful return of Apollo 11 were like all the days after Christmas that every 10-year-old kid has ever experienced rolled into one. What do you do now? Those big projects, and I wanted to be part of one, and I sure was, but they get a hold of you. Your life is not your own. And I don't regret any of it, but it's tough. People don't think of these things as human undertakings, but they are. If you're present at something like that, you realize that you are present at some unique and extraordinary historical event. And I think people do realize that, and we did realize it, and you somehow try to fix it in your mind, what you're feeling. And it's hard to do. It's amazingly hard to do because your attention is nevertheless outwardly focused on what you're listening to and what you're seeing. But there's still a part of you in the inside that wants to have this video permanently in your memory. Because you know it's an event in your life that will never occur again in the same way.